In the last couple of lessons, you learned basics of MySQL, how to connect PHP to database using PDO, you learned about SQL injection, and so on. In this video, let's dive a bit deeper and explore other things related to working with databases like database transactions, how to use config file or env files instead of hard coding database credentials, and so on. Before we get started though, I want to address a couple of things that were brought up to my attention related to the previous PDO lesson. The first concern was that I passed a variable directly in the query right here instead of using prepared statements. Let me clarify what I meant, because I did cut out some parts from that last video while editing related to this exact thing, simply because I didn't think it was that important. But now I see that I should have probably kept it and you would have addressed this concern. First, let me say that I do completely agree and encourage that you should always use prepared statements whenever you can. There is no reason to inject variables into queries directly like this, even when data is internal, unless of course the place you're injecting to doesn't support placeholders or named parameters, in which case you would take other measures like whitelisting, for example, to ensure the safety of your data and queries. That being said though, the context and intent matters. The only reason I even had this query to begin with was to simply avoid jumping back and forth with MySQL Workbench to confirm that user was created on every page refresh, wasting both your and my time. It was simpler to just query the data and display it right here on the screen. This query served no other purpose, and you will see that in the follow-up video, because I don't even use and have that query at all. But still though, I could have probably phrased it a bit differently or even used prepare statements to avoid confusion. You can think of this query as a debug statement. It was simpler and one less line of code to use query method instead of preparing it and then executing the query. Yeah, there is that second order SQL injection case, but we are not storing any data or selecting any data that we are injecting into the query. We're simply casting an ID into an integer and passing the integer into the query. But I should have clarified and phrased it a bit better, or not cut out the part that I left out from the last lesson, which would have made more sense. Also note that some videos have follow-up videos and some videos are split into multiple parts like the PDO lesson. This is the part two, so judging something from a single video is pointless since it may have already been addressed in the next video, which brings me to the next concern that was brought up. Concern was that I should only have the PDO connection part within the try-catch block and not include all of this other code within it. Because if one of these queries threw an exception, we caught it and then we would rethrow the exception again, which would be pointless. And I 100% agree with that. And in fact, in the follow-up video, which is this video that you're about to see, and which was recorded before these concerns were raised, you will notice that I did this exact same thing. I simply put the PDO connection to try-catch block and moved other queries out of it, which goes back to the point I made earlier. As I mentioned before, the PDO lesson was split into multiple videos. I realized it while editing the first video that I got carried away while talking about the important stuff and simply continued writing the queries within the same try-catch block. Once I realized it, I fixed it, and that fix is within the part two of the lesson, which is this video. Either way, I did not think either of these things were a big deal, but since it was brought up to me, I decided to edit this video, which was already pre-recorded, and address them here. I'm totally open to criticism as long as it's constructive, but taking things out of context and being negative is not cool. It would have been a lot better and nicer for the person who reached out to me to raise these concerns a bit differently. For example, it would have been 100 times better if comment with these concerns were posted in the last video on the YouTube. That way I would have addressed it there and everyone else could have stated their opinions. It could have been a nice, productive and interesting conversation or a debate. I take this channel and my content seriously and I listen to my viewers whether the feedback is good or bad, and I appreciate all kinds of feedback. That is why I did not ignore these concerns, which I could have done, but instead I decided to address them and clarify and make things clear. I do apologize for taking a few extra minutes of your time, so let's continue with the lesson. Let's start with the database transactions. In simple terms, a transaction is kind of like a sequence of one or more SQL statements or operations that are treated as a whole or as a unit. A classic example that you might come across on where you would use database transactions is when transferring money from one account to another, like transferring from checking account to savings account. You would have at least two queries, one to decrease the checkings account balance and one to increase the savings account balance. And then you might have some additional queries, probably one maybe to log this action somewhere in a table called transfers or transactions and so on. The queries would look something like this. So you would have the first query to update the checkings account table, where you would decrement the balance by $2,000, for example, for a specific account number. Then you would have a second query where you're updating the savings account and you're increasing or incrementing printing the balance by $2,000 for a specific account. And then the third query where you would be inserting a new row to the transfers table logging this transaction or this action. Now, what happens if the first query was successful and it decreased the balance on the checkings account by $2,000, but then something went wrong before it had a chance to execute the second query to increase the savings balance by $2,000? Or maybe it failed while executing that second query. This means that your checkings account would decrease by $2,000 and your savings account would not increase by $2,000, and therefore you would be short of $2,000. So if we look at these queries again, we see that we have a sequence of queries that has to be executed at the same time while each query is depending on the success of another query. Meaning that if one of them fails to execute for whatever reason, the whole sequence of queries or whole batch of queries would need to revert their actions and go back to the original state. This is where transactions can help. We can wrap this process in a transaction, and you can think of this as kind of like a box or a unit that contains all these queries, where you would begin the transaction right before the start of the sequence or before running the first query, and then at the end of the sequence, if there are no errors, you would commit the entire sequence or batch of queries, which means that only at that point it would actually update the tables at once. If at any point it failed to execute anything, you would be able to easily roll back the entire sequence or batch of queries. Now, I know this is a very classic example, but we can also apply this to a more realistic example, unless of course you're building a banking app, in which case the example that I just told you would apply. But let's think of another example. Let's say that you have a form where a user signs up or registers and selects a subscription plan. When a user submits this request, it will likely run a few queries. One query would be to create the user in the users table, another query would be to create a subscription in the subscriptions table and then associate the user with the subscription, for example. Then you would have another query to log the entire request, maybe another query to save the invoice that was generated and processed as a result of this action, and so on. So you would run quite a few queries, right? Now, without transactions, if error happened at any point, you would be left with inconsistent data, where some tables were updated while some did not. With transactions, however, you could roll back all queries that are within the transaction or commit them at the end if there were no errors. Do note that not all databases or engines support transactions, but the default engine on MySQL, which is InnoDB, does support transactions. Storage engines are kind of components in MySQL that handle the SQL operations, depending on table types. InnoDB is the default one, and also it's the general purpose engine, and it is commonly used, especially if you want foreign keys and transaction support. MyISAM is another common engine and used to be the default one a while back, but does not support foreign keys and transactions. Also, InnoDB does the row level locking while MyISAM does table level locking. InnoDB is what is most often used. And it's also the default one since MySQL version 5.5, I think, so you don't even need to worry about it or specify it when creating tables. So let's use transactions with PDO. I have modified the code a little bit from the last lesson, so let's go over it quick. We have this try-catch block here that handles the PDO connection. Then we have some data hard-coded here, and again, this data could be coming from a form, post or get superglobals, and so on. Then we have two queries that we're preparing, one query to create a new user and another one to create a new invoice for that user. We are executing the user query here, and then we're getting the user ID using the last insert ID method, and then we're executing the new invoice statement passing that user ID so that the invoice can be created for that specific user. And finally, to confirm that both user and invoice has been created, we have this query to fetch the data from both users and invoices table. So we're kind of simulating a user signing up while selecting a subscription plan or something like that. So user signs up, we create a user, and then we generate an invoice, and then maybe we process it and so on. Now, this all looks good, but if something were to go wrong at the second query right here when creating an invoice, this could cause some problems because we're not using transactions, right? Essentially, what can happen is that this query will get executed and it will create a new user account. But then if something were to go wrong for the second query, which creates an invoice and maybe throws an exception, it would not create a new invoice. And therefore, it would be left the user account that was created without an invoice. And then maybe you caught the exception and you showed the user some kind of error message asking them to retry again. And then once the user went back and tried to submit the form again with the same information, the user would get a different error indicating that the user with that email already exists. And again, that's because this block here executed only partially and only user was created and not the invoice. We can solve this by using transactions. So we can begin the transaction here. So we can call begin transaction, and then we can commit right after we create the invoice. Now we also need to roll back the transaction if something goes wrong. If an exception is thrown anywhere within this block here, we need to catch that exception and roll back the transaction. So we can wrap this whole thing within a try catch block. So we can do try and then catch any exception and simply roll back. Now rollback method can also throw an exception if there is no active transaction, and also begin transaction can throw an exception if there is already a transaction that is active. To be safe, I like to also add a check here to make sure that we roll back when we have an active transaction. So we can check if there is an active transaction using in transaction method, only then we can call the rollback method. Please note that you should rethrow the exception within the catch block after the if statement. I'm simply not going to do that here because I want to execute the select query below, so that way we can confirm that no user was created. Now let's try this out and see if it works. I'm going to refresh the page here, and sure enough, we get the invoice ID, the amount, the user ID, and the full name, which means that both user and the invoice was created. We can simply throw an exception before executing the second query to simulate something going wrong with the second query. So let's do throw new exception, and let's change the email and name to Jane, and let's refresh the page. And sure enough, we're not getting anything back, which indicates that neither user nor the invoice was created. Please note that you must call lastInsertID method before the commit method. If we for whatever reason committed the transaction before using the lastInsertID, this will return zero. So let's var dump user ID here, and let's change the email to something else so that it doesn't give us the duplicate error. Let's refresh the page, and as you can see, we're getting zero, even though this was technically executed successfully. If we open up the workbench and run the query to select all the users, we see that j@do.com was created successfully. So make sure that you call lastInsertID before the commit method. So let's revert this back. Let's remove the exception and let's move on. The controller is doing too much here, and also we have these credentials hard-coded. So the first thing we need to do is that we need to remove the hard-coded credentials from here and move them into something called environment variables. There are many benefits to using environment variables and environment files, and one of the major benefit is that you're not hard coding credentials like this into the code, and you're not committing that code into the repository, because you eventually will commit the code into the repository, right? And even if it's private repository, you still don't want your database credentials to be in your commit history. So let's create env files. I'm going to create two files. One is going to be the env file and another one is going to be env.example, and the env.example file is simply a template that will contain all the environment variables that your application needs, but it will not contain any of the values. The values will go into the env file. So this way you can commit the env example file into your repository, which will have no values, it will just have the variables, and then you would add the env file to the gitignore list so you would not commit the actual env file. So let's see what we need. We need the db host, which is set to db, then we need db user, which is set to root, and then we need db password, which is set to root as well, and then we need db database, which is set to my_db. Now, as I mentioned, the env example file should not contain any values, so we need to copy this and move it into the env file, and within the example we can remove the values, and this is the file that you would commit to the repository, and then you would simply add the env file to the gitignore list. Now that we have these environment variables, we won't be able to access them using the env superglobal. So if we var dump the env db host, for example, and refresh the page, we're going to get the undefined warning because db host does not exist yet. And it doesn't work because our environment file has not been loaded yet. We could use a third-party package called php.env to help us load the environment variables. So if we go to the GitHub repository for the php.env and scroll down, we see the instructions to get it installed. So we'll copy the composer command and let's install it. And it pulled in a few other dependencies and installed. And then let's keep scrolling, and we see that we need to load it using this snippet of code here. So let's copy this, and we need to put this within our entry point to the application, and that is public index.php in our case. So let's open that, and we can put it right here. Now, one thing to note here is that this will try to locate the env file within the current directory of the index.php, but that's not where our env files are. Our env file is within the root directory. directory. So we need to go one level above. We could simply use their name function to get the path of the parent directory, and this should work. Now, if we go back to the localhost and refresh the page, we are getting this error that it's not able to locate the env files. And that's probably because I created the env files in the wrong location. So we need to create them within the src directory. So I need to move it within the source directory here. And now that should work. If I refresh the page, we see that it has loaded the environment variable and we can access it using the env superglobal. Now do note that you can have lots of other environment variables within your env files. It doesn't have to just contain the database credentials. You can put your API credentials there. You can put some other configuration related values there and so on. You can even build a config class that would read environment variable values and store them into some kind of array and then cache that data and then use that config class to access the data and not use the env superglobal directly. And now we could easily replace this with environment variables instead of hard coding them here. If I refresh the page, everything works and we're getting false because it threw a duplicate exception because we're trying to create a user with the same email address that we already created before. But the good thing is that our connection works and this did not throw any exceptions. You could even extract this MySQL driver into the environment variable and pull that in from the env superglobal if you wanted to. You can read up more on the php.env package. There are some options and methods available that can be useful. For example, you could make certain environment variables required, check for specific types, only allow certain values, and so on. This is it for this video. Hope you enjoyed it. Thank you so much for watching. If you have any questions or feedback, please post them down below. Otherwise, I'm going to see you in the next video where we're going to clean this up a little bit because right now you'll agree that it looks pretty ugly, right? Our controller knows and does too much. It knows how to connect to the database. It runs the queries. It communicates with the view and so on. So we're going to fix that up in the next video. So thanks again. Hit the like button if you enjoyed it, share and subscribe, and I'll see you next time.